Anyway, hi there.
Hi.
Hey, hi. Okay, well, I believe Inon is ready. Are you ready for the presentation about traditional agriculture to technology-based agriculture? Where is Inon? Is he with us? Okay, here it is. Okay, this is Inon. He is a tour guide, and he is a third-generation farmer from a nearby kibbutz. We are former neighbors, and we are currently unemployed tour guides. So, yeah, but we are still tour guides. It's deep in our souls. As you know, I'm doing virtual tours, as you all know, I guess, and Julia, if we have any new participants here. And Inon is doing exactly what you can see on his shared screen now. And that's actually him inside this huge green John Deere. And then as soon as the pandemic is over and you will be back, so he will quit the John Deere and he will keep guiding tours because he's an amazing tour guide. I highly recommend it. So starting from now on, this is Inon's presentation. And I will keep quiet. Now, we have the chat, as we always do. So please, you're welcome to write any questions, anything you would like to share, add, ask on the chat. And Inon will refer to it in the end of the presentation because he's having a hard time talking and reading chat at the same time. So you're welcome to write anytime, and you will get the answer in the end of the presentation. All right, here we go. Inon, it's all yours. Please unmute yourself and get on the stage.
Thank you, Julia, for this lovely presentation. It's been a pleasure, and thank you guys for having me here in this little community of Zoom participants of this great place. So my name is Inon. I was born and raised here in Israel on a kibbutz, not too far from where we're sitting today, Leah and I. And for me, that's was part of life. And farming is the way of life. For the last 15 years, I've been doing what you can see at the upright corner, which is tour guiding, because this has been my life for a very, very, very long time, which I love very, very much. But as you know, from the COVID-19 crisis, we all had to rethink it and try to go back to our roots. And I did it as much as literally as I can and went back to my roots as a kibbutznik and farmer. I'm a third generation farmer. My grandparents immigrated from Poland to this kibbutz named Ein Shemer. And my grandfather was the first in the line of farmers in our family. My father and uncle continued with this tradition for many, many years. My brother continued with that today, and I rejoined him because that's what I did for many years while living on the kibbutz, was working on the tractor and, in a way, being a redneck myself. It's been a fun and interesting way of living, and from all the possibilities of what we can do on when you're dealing with the COVID-19 situation, I think that was the best option I could have had. So from a tour guide to farmer in speed time, that was a lot of fun and keeps me outside of the neon lights. So you're probably wondering, how do you turn this? And I don't know if you guys recognize, but that's the Jordan Valley. That's the exit of the River Jordan from the Sea of Galilee, making its way down to the Dead Sea. For the ones who need to be. So this is the Sea of Galilee over here, and that's the Jordan River coming out and making its long way down towards the Dead Sea, and you turn it in into the Jordan Valley, we all know today, green, luscious, and full of farming and full of life. And that's a hard thing to say. I always, when I try to speak about Israel, I'll say, in a way, we're lying to you guys in your face, because you've all been to Israel, and it's so green and so beautiful. But it takes the hard work of many brave people, many brave souls. Not every one of them managed to get to the finish line to turn this into that. And it, for us, is a great pleasure and a great thinking of how we can continue this amazing tradition. So going back to traditional farming in Israel, going back to the 19th century, Israel was maybe still in the medieval times. On the right-hand side, you can see the Turkmenic Bedouins still plowing the field with a wooden plow and a camel. The first advancement of farming came from the Templars, not the Knight Templars, but the ones you've seen maybe in Haifa and Sarona in Tel Aviv and the German colony in Jerusalem. All of those places were turned by the German Templars who came in at the middle of the 19th century. We're talking about 1860, when they came over here, and they actually turned this place around. They brought new techniques of farming, new techniques of building, new technologies that haven't been heard before, specifically like internal combustion engines. This tractor you see on the left-hand side is one of four existing in the world that was renovated not too far from where I am right now as part of a joint combination to bring life back to the technology, the farming technology that we had. But really going back to where we were so many years ago, I think one of the advantages of the farming that was done by the Jewish population over here, and here we see the first and second Aliyot that came here from Poland, that came from Russia. Romania was actually a big contributor. That people that came with very little farming tradition. Jews were not farmers back in Europe. They were industrial, they were money launderers, they were tailors and many, many things like that. But you wouldn't see so many farmers as Jewish. And because of that, when they came here, even farming here in Israel versus farming in Europe, when you get rain in the middle of summer, very different soil, when you have to do all these things to reinvent yourself, who would you go to learn from? The locals. But you don't only learn from the locals how to farm. You also think that you should look like them and act like them. And on the left-hand side picture, you can see the first members of Hashomer. They're dressed like Arabs, ride their horses like Arabs. They felt that this is the way to go. In the first and second Aliyah, most of the employees were Arabs. But with the third Aliyah, the third wave of Jews coming to Israel, they've decided that they should conquer this advancement of working in the fields. They should be the ones giving the presentations and actually working themselves. And for doing that, you had to reinvent yourself. So in a way, the lack of farming tradition enabled them to find new ways to take the farming to a different level. If I have to think about the biggest problem that we have today, and we had for all over the years here in Israel, is lack of water. Guys, go back to the Bible. Go back to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. They all went to Egypt, and they went there because there was a famine and there was a drought, and they couldn't stay here in the land. Egypt had the River Nile, never had problems with water, could always irrigate from the River Nile. There are no problems of water in Egypt. I know that Joseph might disagree with me, but let's face it, as long as the River Nile goes, they have water. So we need to rethink ourselves and see how we actually solve this big problem of water. The second problem is that much of the soil that we have here is not really able to give us the kind of produce we want. We need to find ways to either make the soil fertile enough and clear the soil that is not inhabitable. And the most important thing is research. Guys, back from the 19th century all the way till today, we have researchers working here and trying to find new ways from finding the mother of the wheat, which means the seed that from it all the different brands of wheat were developed, what men domesticated around 1 million years ago, all the way till today, to be able to give you a nicer and better cherry tomato to your breakfast table. It's all done with development. It's all done with the fact that people had to sit down with a piece of paper and start to think their views and their visions to what they should do. But let's start with the biggest problem, water. My good friends, water is what gives us life. To be able to give us water in a land that is missing so much, we had to all the time think outside of the box. We have different sources of water, starting with groundwater. For hundreds of years, people know how to dig in the ground and get water out of the ground. But is that enough? Do we have enough precipitation? Do we have enough rain to continue supplying us with water? And my good friends, the answer is no. We have to all the way time think of how to get more water. So we all know this. Let me get the... here. You all know this, the Sea of Galilee, great source of water. But to be able to have enough water in the Sea of Galilee, we need to have years and years of good rain. Thank God the last few years have been very good, and the Sea of Galilee is still in one of its highest points. Even in the end of summer today, when you drive around it, you enjoy this beautiful view of a full Sea of Galilee. But that's not enough for a country that now have over 9 million people living in it. To be able to give enough drinking water, we started to produce water. And here we're actually seeing the desalinization plant from Ashkelon. Hundreds, if not thousands, of these units are producing water. Today, 50% of Israel's drinking water come from these kind of plants. We take this water, and the one that we don't have to use directly, we bring back into the ground to enrich the groundwater situation that is not always being supplied properly by the rain. But that's very, very expensive water. How can we make sure that we'll have more water for other use than just drinking? In the left-hand corner, where I'm pointing right now, we're seeing one of the reservoirs down in the Arava, next to the Dead Sea. This is taking the water. You might not see it right now, but imagine that there's a flow of water here, a huge stream of water. This reservoir is gathering those water from the side, not where the major flow is. And this water will be irrigating the greenhouses that are right here in this corner. These are great water that just flow from all the way from Sinai sometimes to the Dead Sea. By harvesting those water and not let them go to waste, We're able to use them for farming. We're doing the very same thing up on the Golan and all over Israel, gathering those water instead of enabling them to flow into the either Mediterranean Sea, Dead Sea, or Sea of Galilee. We're harvesting those water to make sure we'll have enough water to use. The next and maybe the most important option we have today is this, reclaimed water. 90% of sewer in Israel is collected today into reservoirs, and it goes through water purification stations like those. We're bringing it back in some cases to the level that you can actually re-drink those water. Those water are so good. You can irrigate even vegetables with them, which are the most problematic for irrigation because they contain the most amount of water within them and the least amount of surface from ground to plant. And this is why you need to have very high quality water. But that's not enough. We found two other sources of water that are called fossil water. One down in the Arava and the Negev, and the other one up on the Golan. These are water that were contained through millions of years ago into underground reservoirs. We're talking about water that have been flowing there millions, I'm talking 4 and 5 million years ago, and were trapped in aquifers. You have to dig sometimes more than a mile down to be able to get to those water. Are those water good for drinking? None. They contain very high levels of sulfur and other minerals that are not necessarily good to be used directly by us. But by cleaning them, by removing the sulfur, lowering the amount of minerals in them, we're able to find ways to irrigate with them. There are many ways of irrigation. We'll start with maybe the more traditional ones. You might have seen it from Southeast Asia, how they irrigate the rice fields by flooding. But this is a very, very wasteful way of irrigation. When you irrigate the whole surface of the field, you're wasting a lot of water. And if we say we don't have enough water, we need to find a way to make sure that the water will get directly to the plant. Same thing by using sprinklers. The whole ground is wet. And we need to make sure that sometimes that's the best thing to do, because sometimes in certain places you need the whole ground to be moist. But it's still very wasteful of water because not every drop of water gets directly to the plant. And here comes this nice gentleman on the right-hand side corner. Name is Simcha Balas. He noticed, he's one of the founders of Mekorot, which is the water company of Israel, this who supplies to most of us the water to our taps, or make sure it will get to the entrance to your village or town or whatever, in every place you live. He noticed that by the tap, you see the most amount of weeds. Why? Because they know where the wet, because they can enjoy the wet surfaces. He says, why should I get the whole field wet if I can make sure I'll get the drops of water directly to the plant? That's not easy, because you need to know where the plant is and to make sure it will be in that location. And how do you control? How do you make sure that, like on the left-hand side corner, every drop of water gets to the plant itself? It's not easy, but you have to, but where there's a will, there's a way. So finding a way of moving the water through a pipe and having the pipe drip in a certain location, in a certain pressure, because the farmer wants to know exactly how much water he needs to give to those plants. And here we actually see the development of the drip irrigation from the earliest one here, from the mid 60s, all the way till today. At first, there was a drip every meter, let's say, that and between these two pieces of pipe. But when you have to roll the pipe back on a big roll at the end of the growing season, this is very, very ineffective because it makes the pipe much, much weaker. These two were developed to irrigate plants like avocado trees, oranges, and things that go on a multiple level, multiple year level, not something that is a 3, 4, 5 months season, and that you put into the pipe, and it gives you the exact amount of water you choose according to how much water you want to irrigate. Each one gives a different amount to the plant. The big advancement came in the early 80s. How do you insert the drip into a pipe, and then the pipe goes straight through the field and irrigates, and then it's easy also to roll it back at the end of a season onto a big roll. And until today, the drip irrigation is maybe the most accepted way of irrigation in many, many locations all over the world. Netafim, which is the company that was founded by Kibbutz Chatzirim together with Simcha Balas and works together with Kibbutz Magal, is one of the most important, and maybe I can say the leading company in developing new ways of irrigation and controlling them. But today we have much, much better ways to actually know how much water we need to give. The idea of not wasting water is maybe the best thing to do. This system that we see here is based over sensors that go into the ground, computer that gather all that information and then gives you those graphs that show you exactly what you need to do. How much water does the plant need? How much fertilizer do you need to add to the water? All of the things are measured on an hourly base, and the plant can actually send you a text message. Your WhatsApp will call you and tell you, my friend, I'm thirsty. Why don't you give me some water and a little bit of fertilizer would be nice as well. By using those systems, we're able to optimize the amount of water and not just irrigate because we feel it and we think that we need it. It actually gives you the exact measurements of how much you need to irrigate. Solutions for soil and land is maybe the hardest thing to do, because water, we've seen, we can produce, but land is a little bit harder. And how do you turn a swamp into a fertile field? Is first you need to drain the swamps. Draining the swamps was one of the biggest actions in the 40s and 50s here in Israel. And the Hula Valley that today is a very fertile valley, as you see on the right corner, had to be first drained and emptied from the swamp that gathered it. And maybe this is the best way to gather the land, but I'm not sure it was so good for the environment. We're seeing the effect on the environment until today. The swamp is trying to go back, and the fight goes back and forth. But what do you do in places like the Negev? when the soil is really not good, how do you actually deal with those amount of land that you want to irrigate and you want to cultivate, but you cannot do it because the soil is not good? And here comes new technology. You disconnect the ground from the plant, and you actually bring new soil. It can enable you to have a much, much more efficient way of cultivating. If you look at the right-hand side, you see how a strip of land is put inside the greenhouse and you plant the tomatoes inside. There's actually no connection from the plant itself to the soil it sits on. But you have enough land in the Negev to create those greenhouses. Look at the advantage of having the strawberries up in the air. Oh, sorry, I need to go to the back. You have the strawberries in the air, much easier to harvest than if you actually had to bend down and pick every strawberry from the ground. Imagine how nice it is to work with the lettuce here when you don't have to bend down. So this enables us to make the areas we're actually growing things much, much bigger, because we can detach from the soil itself. Another way of growing without the need for soil is hydroponic. Hydroponic, you're actually using the water. We discovered a long time ago. The earliest researches about that are from the 1600s. That the plants actually don't need the soil. If they have all the minerals in the water, the roots can actually receptive it without the need to be stocked in soil. By that, I can create multi-levels of lettuce or any other agricultural growth that I want to use in hydroponic. I make sure that the water will contain enough minerals from all sorts, but then I continue on to the next without the need to use soil. And now let's go to maybe the most advanced way we're talking about today. GPS and other technologies that actually give us the ways to control our fields and control our implements without the need to do things again and again and again. Today, almost every tractor, every harvester is equipped with a GPS system connected to the network. If you look at the right-hand side, the lower picture, the different colors are what the farmer will get at the end of every harvest year. What do they mean? It gives you exactly how much produce you had from this specific location inside the field over the year. Why is it so important? Because the next step will be preparing the field for the next year. But if I know that a certain location gave me very little amount of produce, what should I do? And the answer is I should find a way to fertilize it. But why do I need to give the fertilizer, which is very expensive, to the whole field the same amount? If I can connect my fertilizer to the very same GPS map that the tractor is enjoying and the harvester is enjoying, and this way, it will give the fertilizer in the spot that I received less produce this year. And the next year, I'll be able to even it up the whole field. In many cases, it's either not good for the plants or impossible to go over the field. If the field is too wet and you need to, let's say, use pesticides or herbicides or even fertilizer for a wet field. So guys, look at the left-hand picture. An army of drones can do all that work for you. You bring those maps, you upload those maps into the drone system, and those drones will fly over your field and will know to either use fertilizers, herbicides, pesticides, all the treatments you need to do, but you don't want or can't go over the field, will be done through computer-based technology to enable us to give us enough information and give them the right way to continue doing it. Guys, I think whenever everybody speaks about Israeli farming, they all speak about the amazing produce that we actually have here. When we speak about Israel in the 50s and 60s and 40s, almost 50% of our export was farming. And the most known one is the one in the center, the Jaffa oranges. Who doesn't know the Jaffa oranges? Lots of flavor, lots of juice, and very, very easy to peel. And it was sold not just the oranges themselves. We sold those kind of oranges to be grown all over the world. But we didn't stop there. We invested in searching for new things to grow, because the markets get harder and harder. New species of avocados that are actually dealing with the kind of climate and soil we have here. On the right bottom side, you can see the Anna apples. The Anna apple is actually was developed on the kibbutz where I was born by a very nice gentleman. And he was awarded a very big prize from the Egyptian government, because the Egyptian government invested a lot in growing these kind of apples in Egypt. They had very big success. But I'm pretty sure you guys know that the crown pearl of Israeli fruits and vegetables is what we see here on the right, on the left-hand side, the cherry tomato. We did not invent the tomato. The tomato was invented a long time before we came into the market, but we made it smaller and much, much sweeter. By the way, one of the things that we discovered, and going back to what we spoke of earlier, when we found the fossil water that contained a lot more minerals, that means a little, the water feels a little salty when you will drink it. When you irrigate the tomatoes with this kind of water, the solution, the outcome is a much, much sweeter tomato. You know what? That exact thing happened also with the red peppers. When we do it, when we develop new species of vegetables, we need to understand not only the Israeli market, but also the export market. And the main export market from Israel goes to the European market. And they need to have that perfect specimen when it goes to the table. Smaller but much hotter cucumbers. And look at this big variety of zucchinis that you can find today when you go to a farmer's market. These are all things that were developed here in Israel. This amazing cantaloupe that have a long shelf life will enable the farmers to harvest and sell and export. And it sits on grows in Israel and will sail to Europe and will sit in the supermarket and then in somebody's refrigerator. it needs a long shelf life. It cannot go to waste and cannot go bad in a week. We have to find a way to prolong the life of all of these fruits and vegetables. And that's what a lot of researchers try to do, is to make sure that the shelf life of these kind of produce is what you'll get at the end of the day. Not every development that is drawn and acted goes all the way to being produced. What we have here, and for me this is a touchy point on an emotional level, because this big tractor you see before you that was developed in the late 70s, early 80s, my father was one of the people that developed it. He's going to celebrate his 84th birthday this November. Never made it to be produced, but showed the innovation of Israeli farmers, people that came from the ground. They were not professors. They were not sitting in universities. They acknowledged a necessity of how to optimize the use of the field, how you give it the most amount of time and most amount of the least amount of time, but the most amount of produce by using the least amount of work time, because at the end of the day, every single thing costs money. If it's fuel, if it's water, we need to take all of these things together and try to make sure that what we get at the end of the day is the best produce, and the farmers will actually make a living. And that's what is so important. And I haven't opened the chat box yet to see if there are any questions. Julia, you wanna join me for the part where we answer questions?
Hey, Inon.
Yes, I'm with you.
Okay. All right, just making sure that you can hear me. Okay. So we have a few questions here. Well, one is actually, I don't even understand the question. I hope you will. And the question is there any need for crop dusting in Israel anymore? I have no idea what crop dusting is.
Yes, there is still a need for crop dusting. When you grow over big fields, you cannot control the pesticides that come into your field. Mm-hmm. We try to minimize it. We try to do things that will kill the pesticides in the ground without the use. For example, when you're ending a season of cotton, you plow the field to bury the stumps of the cotton, so the little larvae that are in it will not grow the next year, will not be able to fly the next year and eat the cotton from within. You're doing crop rotation. You grow every year a different crop over the field. This way you can treat the field with less pesticides and less herbicides, because some crops minimize the enemies of other crops. But when you grow within greenhouses and net houses, what you do today is the use of, you know, the term that the enemy of your enemy is your friend. So we bring those flies, sometimes small wasps, into the greenhouse, and they will attack all the enemies of your plants. So we still have to use crop dusters. We still have to use chemicals, it's not only green farming completely, but we try to minimize it to not harm the environment as much as we used to.
Okay, great. Now there is another question. What is the method used to extend the shelf life of fruit and vegetables?
This goes back to the research part. There's not a lot you can do actually in the field, but what you do when you develop the new kind of vegetable, you try to give it enough genes that will make it much stronger. But for example, just one thing is bananas. When you harvest bananas, do you know what color? They're not yellow. If I will harvest the bananas yellow, I will end up with a black banana 4 days later before it will even reach your shelf. But what you do is actually harvest the banana when they're still green, and right before it goes into the market, you accelerate the ripening process by treating it with a special gas that will develop the parts in the banana that will make it go ripe.
Okay. All right. Next question is, how is cross-pollination performed in greenhouses without bees?
You actually bring the bees into the
greenhouse.
You have to make sure you have bees. We human beings are amazing. We've done a lot of things, a lot of researches, and we're trying to replace the birds and the bees. We can't. We still need the bees to do it. We bring special kind of bombus beans, bees that were developed here in Israel. You bring a beehive into the greenhouse and they will do the fertilization of the plants for us. These are things that no one can do better than them. Yes, Julia.
All right. Well, okay. Well, we have a remark. It's not a question. Oh, but it's actually privately. Okay. There is an explanation for me what a crop duster is. So yeah, I got it. It's yeah. I know what it is. All right. Thanks. All right, so we don't have other questions as far as I can see. People said a few things, but these are not questions. There was a question, which kibbutz are you born in, but I already answered this one. This one I know well. Yeah, well, these are the questions. If we have any other questions, so you, okay. There is a question from Steve. Okay. It is asked privately, but I guess this is a question for Inon. I think so. So the question is, how is the future looking?
How does the future look? They said that the prophecy was given to the fools, but the future of farming is problematic in many ways, because we have to all the time try to see how you actually make money out of it. It's not that easy. Some markets go up, some markets go down, and every year we see more and more crops being changed. Sometimes you can grow chickpeas, but then the next year you'll have to find something else that will yield you enough money. I think on a technology level, we will see a lot more use of technologies in farming, because one of the things that demand the most amount of money in farming is actually the working hands. More and more things are harvested manually. That used to be harvested manually are today harvested by machines. If it's grapes, even apples are harvested today predominantly by machines, and much less by actually working hands, people that are picking the fruits and vegetables out of the field. From my expertise in cotton, for example, what we used to have 10 people doing together, from the harvester all the way, from the cotton picker all the way to the truck that takes it to the gin, today we have two or three people doing that, because the harvester, the cotton picker is picking the cotton and already wrapping it and getting it ready, and you just need the truck to take it to the gin, and that's about it. So a lot less working hands today are needed in the farming industry, and in a way it replaces the many, many people that we had to have. So it makes it a lot more economical for the farmers to be able to survive the crises. At least here in Israel, as long as farming is considered a valuable industry, even if they close us back in the houses due to the COVID-19, they let us farmers out to work the fields. But everything changes, and who knows what will be tomorrow.
Okay, next one is, how profitable is farming in Israel?
This is the $1 million that we don't have question. Because when you look at the picture itself of whether everything I showed you actually makes enough money to be able to be profitable enough, in many cases the answer is no. But farming in Israel is a lot more than just making money. To make the Negev bloom and raise tomatoes in the middle of the desert is not just it's not just for economical reasons. If we're not there, somebody else will work the soil, and for us it's pure Zionism. It's understanding that the soil, if I'm not going to be the one plowing it and harvesting it and all of that, somebody else will do it, and he's not necessarily Jewish. And for us it's a big part. It's a very important role that the farming have played in the life of Israel as a sovereign nation.
Okay. Does Israel produce most of its own food?
The answer is yes and no. Because on the level of vegetables such as cucumbers, tomatoes, red peppers, apples, the majority of fruits and vegetables that you'll find in supermarkets are Israeli. In certain seasons when we don't have enough, we do import from Turkey and even from the United States. Wheat, for example, and corn, I think that 90% of the wheat used in Israel for bread products and all of that is imported. Same with corn for the food industry. Most of that is imported. There's a funny story that one of the ministers came to Levi Eshkol, who was the prime minister, and says, Eshkol, you know there's a drought coming. Eshkol said, in Israel, in the United States? He says, no, in Israel. He says, as long as the United States continue to produce wheat, I'm good. So Israel can stand on its 2 feet for certain things on a farming, on our produce, but not everything.
Yeah, and we don't have enough beef as well. Beef and fish are mostly imported, red meat. Yeah, that's right. So now somebody wrote, Mark wrote, thank you to Dalva. You should copyright the t-shirt. There is no replacing the birds and the bees. So that's something for you to consider. And the question now, how much success has been in the negative?
How much farming is there in the negative?
How successful farming in the negative is?
Actually, it's one of the most successful areas of farming in Israel. In farming, timing is everything. And we all know that timing is important. Because if you bring your produce when nobody else have it, you can charge $10 for a pound of tomatoes. If you bring your tomatoes when everybody are producing, you can charge $3. So you want to make sure that you bring your produce predominantly when the market is not flooded. And the Negev and the Arava and the Judean desert by the Dead Sea, since they have a much longer summer there, it's almost summer all year round. Actually, when in the heat of summer, they don't raise anything, but they can raise through fall, winter, and spring and make sure they produce. If you come to Israel in May and you find watermelons, they came from the Arava. They cannot be raised anywhere else in Israel because it's not warm enough to produce it. So farming in the Negev is quite successful, and they're able to work in many ways to maximize their profits. Julia?
Yeah, okay. Yeah, I'm muting myself by mistake. Okay. Who are the biggest competitors for farming? I guess we're talking about countries.
It varies. If we need to think about the apple orchards, for example, in the Golan in the Galilee, their competitor sits in Vermont. If they send us their Pink Lady here that are cheaper to produce, we cannot compete. Oranges, the biggest competition is Spain. Same with chickpeas. Israeli farmers have to compete with Turkish farmers on growing tomatoes. I think what stands for Israeli produce most in everything is quality, quality, quality. And that's what the consumers know to look for Israeli produce because of their higher quality and being able to look for that. And this sells sometimes better than just give them the highest quantity of a certain produce.
Okay. Are the fires destroying lots of crops?
The fires, I think what you've heard, and predominantly around the Gaza Strip with those wonderful balloons that they're sending our way. In the last 3 years since it actually started, the first couple of years, the farmers lost hundreds of acres of predominantly wheat, because that area is raising a lot of wheat for grains. So this year, for example, what the farmers did was harvest the wheat when it's still green. And this is what we do for silage for the, this is what the cows eat, the dairy cows in the sheds eat during the year. The fires did a lot of damage the last couple of years. This year, most of the damage that the fire are doing are for natural habitats, orchards, and not so much orchards, but for area that are more natural and less fields, because everything was harvested earlier, and by that saving the crops from being destroyed.
All right. Carlene wrote, I think I saw patty pan squash, a little flat yellow squash in your last picture. Do you grow that and export that? What other interesting vegetables do you grow that might be new or different for those of us in US or the West? What vegetable is most popular? Do you grow asparagus? Do you grow artichoke? Okay, now that was a long one to review step by step.
Well, every year the research centers in Israel produce new species. Not everything goes into the market, not everything goes into mass producing, but they're able to reinvent vegetables every single year. And that's amazing to see. Usually around Shavuot, they will uncover the new things that they've managed to produce. But everything you see here was developed in research centers in Israel that produces these kind of vegetables.
Which vegetable is the most popular, though? What do you think, Inon?
What I think is that's the most popular?
Yeah.
I think cucumbers and tomatoes. And all its sorts are the most popular, Julia.
Yeah. I think so. Yeah, tomatoes and cucumbers. This is the most basic thing, and this is what we consume most. Okay. How much of Israel's food is homegrown versus imported? Well, I think we addressed this question before. It depends on what. Like, myself as a vegetarian, I have enough food in Israel. A carnivore like Inon, so you depend more upon the import. Again, not enough beef, not enough fish. Question. Equipment and tech is expensive. Does your kibbutz share its machines? None?
Yes. Well, today it's very, very hard for one kibbutz to be able to have and work to, on its own with and have all the machinery. And a lot of kibbutzim joined forces together, and today my kibbutz is moving also towards creating a joining a conglomerate of a few kibbutzim. This way we're able to be more efficient. If a tractor today can process 1,000 acres, if your kibbutz don't have 1,000 acres, it's a way you're wasting money. So if you're working together and you're able to grow on lands of several kibbutzim, you might gather 1,000 or 2,000 or 3,000 acres. This way the equipment will be used in a more efficient way. So these kind of conglomerates of farming groups are becoming more and more popular, process of joining one.
Okay, amazing. Does Israel practice a lot of genetic engineering in their crops? Is this desirable from a nutrition point of view?
Israel have some of it, the development, but I know it's a very, very charged topic. I know the European market, which is for us the biggest market to export, do not approve of it, and I believe that we're not pushing it as much as the American market. We're using some of the American, for example, the corn that we're raising to put the, to have canned corn is an American developed species. It's not an Israeli developed. We import it. And sometimes we have GMOs in it, yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I would like to add also that a lot of these brand new, weird-looking vegetables and fruits, it's not necessarily a result of a genetic engineering, but rather, I don't know the exact term, but it's actually cross-breeding when you push it towards the features you're looking for. I mean, if you have a big tomato plant and then some tomatoes are better than the other tomatoes, so then you will take the seeds and the pollen and then you will produce more of the better tomatoes and then again better and better. So it's not genetic engineering, it actually human facilitated development.
The idea is to take the good qualities of the plant and enhance that. That's not actually bringing genes from other plants or animals, as is done in GMO.
Right. Yeah, it's actually a human orientation of the evolution of the plants. Yeah, something like that. Okay. How much is the cost of an acre of the farmland?
That's a very good question. The cost of raising is according to the crop. Different crops requires different treatment of the soil. How much does it cost to rent an acre of land? It depends on where it is and who are you dealing with. Whether you're dealing with a private property of a certain of the owner, or you actually renting it from the government. So it varies. I cannot and I cannot give you the certain the exact number.
Where do the workers come from?
The workers, let's say until the late 80s, it was locals, Israelis, and Palestinians. From the middle of the first Intifada, when the flow of Palestinian workers have diminished due to different reasons, Israel started to bring in employees from Thailand. And today, until today, a lot of the work is done by workers that come in from Thailand. They come on a 5 years or 6 years visa. Their working environment is exactly as what you, if you would employ an Israeli, you have to supply them with housing. Their pay is not lower than an Israeli minimum wage. You have to give them pension and all the things that is an Israeli worker is entitled, they get the same as well.
Okay, Gail wrote, I eat plants that have been enhanced but not modified with cells from other entities, like cells from pesticides. Do you add pesticide cells to your foods?
I don't know to answer that question. I'm using my I don't know card for once.
Okay, you're good. Well, as far as I know, I'm not 100% sure, but as far as I know, Israeli rules do not allow that because this is pushing the genetic engineering too far. So I think we don't have pesticide cells in our crops, but I don't know either. Okay, Terry asked, why doesn't Israel raise more wheat?
Because the majority of wheat that we raise in Israel is cut green and used as silage and food for the livestock, predominantly cows. We don't have enough land to raise the amount of wheat we need to supply us with wheat for bread.
Well, simply we are too small. I mean, we are,
in North Dakota.
Right, exactly. Like the size of New Jersey. And so we don't have enough space for enough wheat. And we love our pita in our pizza. And we need a lot of wheat. Yeah. Okay.
I believe that most of you have visited Israel, you know that we love carbs.
Mm-hmm. Carbohydrates. Okay. Lynn asked, does your kibbutz in Shemer have volunteers come to work and experience life there? Is this kibbutz privately privatized?
Well, unfortunately, the whole volunteers movement had disappeared in the mid-80s, late 90s for a variety of reasons. So we don't have volunteers anymore, but this, and they came predominantly from the Northern Europe, if it's Denmark or Norway. What was the second part of the question, Julia?
It was, is your kibbutz privatized today?
Yes, my kibbutz was privatized. I think that actually was a huge step forward for most kibbutzim to be that were privatized, because it enables them so much more to the members themselves to optimize their life. And if the kibbutz is able to find the good balance between privatization and still keeping the kibbutz way of life, in the sense of creating the continuing with the culture activities and all of that, that gives the people what they want in the 21st century, because let's be honest, we're not socialists anymore.
Okay, just before we move forward to the next question, I would like to say that I'm so glad that we have so many questions. I don't know how about you, Inon, after having working the whole day in the field, but it's okay. I mean, you volunteered for the presentation, and so
they're so nice, and they stayed up with me. So I'm with.
Well, actually, it is late for.
It's almost 3 p.m. for you guys, right?
Oh yeah, that's a.
For the ones that are not on the West Coast.
For the afternoon nap. So anyhow, I see that we have less participants now, which is normal, because normally after an hour people start like getting out. So whoever feels like he's done, that's perfect. That's fine. Thank you for coming. Thank you for joining.
Thank you for having us.
Exactly. Thank you for letting us speak. And those who are still with us, so it's wonderful, and we will keep asking questions and answering questions as long as you wish. So I would just, before we move forward, I would like to remind you guys that this is a pay what you wish presentation, so any donation is appreciated. You can either use the PayPal account, the usual non-PayPal account, which you got with the link, and then please just make a note that this is for Inon, and it will go directly to him. Otherwise, you can send a check by normal post to Steve Plotkin, and yes, a note, this is for Inon, or agriculture, or something to let us know that this is, you know, that belongs to Inon. And Tuesday, we have a presentation. I said it last tour, and for those who were not with us, we are switching dates. I mean, starting from next week, starting from September, Tuesdays will be presentations, and Thursdays will be live tours, because Noam is going to college. So Tuesday, September 1st, it's going to be a presentation dedicated to the Israeli contemporary art. This presentation, the speaker will be Kinneret Matan. And well, I see that you're happy about Israeli modern agriculture. I hope you will be happy about the Israeli contemporary art. So that's Tuesday, 9 p.m. Israeli time, 2 p.m. Eastern. And then Thursday, it's going to be a live Zoom culinary cooking workshop with Tali Almoz, and we will be cooking for the upcoming holidays. And since it's indoors and we have the light there, so it will be 9 p.m. as well, unlike the tours, which are normally like 6 p.m. Israeli time. So next week is dedicated to art and the art of cooking. All right. So having said that, back to question. How can we in US help farmers in Israel?
Unfortunately, the Israeli market is farming market is not that developed on selling to the U.S. You can buy from Israeli vineyards and Israeli wineries, and the winemakers and the people on the vineyards will enjoy this. I don't know if on Halls Food you can actually buy Israeli farm produce, but when this COVID-19 will go away, come back to visit us. Eat as many vegetables as you can, and you'll help us.
All right. Betty said, please export more persimmons to the U.S. I have trouble finding them. So, please.
It's the export and import agreements between the Israeli government and the U.S. is very, very complex. It's not easy to export fruits and vegetables into the United States of America. And because of that, it is a limited market for us. The main market for Israeli farmers is Europe and Russia.
All right. Joel wrote, I've seen fruit and vegetable produced in the market. It looked good, but not great. Is this because Israel exports the best?
The best is always exported, because and we have a, what we call a, what we, is a like a secondary market, the thing that might not look as amazing but will still taste amazing will stay in Israel and will be sold for a lower cost than what goes out to Europe. So yes, sometimes in the markets themselves you will see in some of the stands things that look not as nice as what you would are used to seeing in the supermarkets, because supermarkets have very, very specific demands, because they want to represent that they give you the best. And markets have a little bit of a different agenda. People want to buy huge amounts in lower cost, so they might decide to present not only, not just the finest produce, but also things that looks equal, the taste equally amazing, but not look as nice.
Okay, there's another question I don't understand. So maybe Stuart, maybe you can explain what you mean. The question is Inon calling it the Richard Center?
The what?
The Richard Center. Stuart, you're welcome to unmute yourself and speak to us.
I was trying to look it up and I couldn't find it. Inon mentioned the Richard Center, I thought you said. Is that correct? For
I don't remember. I did not. Research centers, not Richard.
Okay, I got it. Thank you.
Sorry. Julia, we'll take three more questions.
Okay. You want to go home, huh? Okay. So the question, next question, Maria asked, are all vegetables produced by farmers in Israel can be considered as organic? If not, which one can be considered as conventional way produced?
Okay, not all vegetables produced in Israel are organic. The one that you will, that will be marketed in organic shops or in the organic part of supermarkets are organic. They're not necessarily better. We need to remember that if a plant needs to defend itself from a pesticide or they will develop toxins within it. If the tomato needs to protect itself from a certain pest, it will develop certain toxins in it to attack it. And in a way, when you use the right kind of pesticides, you're helping the plants to deal better with the pest and not having to develop those toxins within them. The rules and regulations dictate that before harvest, you're not allowed a certain amount of time before harvest, you're not allowed to use pesticides. So hopefully by the time it gets to the shelf, the idea is that by the time the fruit gets to the shelf, it will lose the most amount of pesticides from what it had with it or on it. But this is one of the main reasons why we actually have to wash fruits and vegetables before we eat them, because beside the dust, they might have residues of other things on them.
Okay. Is there any cattle or chickens raised in Israel? Well, the answer is yes. This is the simple one. Inon, would you like to add something?
Yes. We raise a lot of cattle in Israel for the milk industry. The majority of cows, the Israeli cows, that's a whole topic I did not go into, is maybe the most productive cow in the world. But we raise very little cattle for the meat industry. Most of that is imported from either Brazil, Argentina, Uruguay, today Poland, Australia, all of those countries. We actually import meat into Israel.
For some reason, Julia and Inon are frozen. Both Israel. I wonder what happened there.
Not sure.
All right.
Well, sure, but maybe that's a good place to end. We have so many. We had so many questions. It looks like.
Yeah. Thank you. Thanks so much for the question. You know, most of us have been social distancing from our refrigerators now for a couple of months, and it's good to know how complicated the things are that go into that refrigerator. I had no real appreciation for the complexity of the farming, and I think he did a great job today in covering that topic. Are there any questions on the table for Ilana or me regarding BFI future programs? Anything that we can repeat that wasn't clear? Just unmute yourself now. We're open session.
Are the times for next week the same as the times for this week? Tuesday, 11, and Thursday, 2.
No, they should be changed because, as Julia said, the tour will be on Thursday and the talk will be on Tuesday.
So
will it be flipped then? Then on Tuesday it should be 2:00 and Thursday will be 11, but we'll be sending out an invitation so you'll have the times on there.
Okay, perfect. Thank you. We don't want to double book with doctors and stuff.
Right. Is that correct, Steve?
That's correct. We'll have to confirm both times, but I believe that's true. 2:00 and 11:00. You'll be getting your Zoom email before Sunday on the next week's program. Now, anybody here who doesn't receive their Zoom codes via an email, usually on Sunday, I suggest that you send an email to vfivolunteer@gmail.com. And if you do that, include your first name, last name, and email address and your state, and we will add you to the list, and you will then therefore get weekly notices of our programs. And our programs, incidentally, are scheduled clear through to the end of this year. So there's plenty of programs, 2 every week going forward, with I think 1 or 2 exceptions for holidays.